Hey, remember Bill Cipher? How could you ever forget? He's everyone's favorite teenage-hating, logic-defying, Dorito-shaped horror. The chaos dream demon of Gravity Falls who trapped the entire city in an apocalypse of weirdness. Yeah, him.
He's back.
And so am I. But things are weird. Different. Gravity Falls ended over 8 years ago, but the Book of Bill, supposedly written by human Alex Hirsch, seems to be a return to that universe, from the perspective of Bill himself. But is Bill supposed to be dead? In the season finale, we all saw him get destroyed by McGucket's memory gun. Yet, here the Tumblr sexy man is, writing his own book. In-universe, does Bill still exist? Is he dead? Alive? In between? What terrible secrets will this unholy grimoire contain? Would I ever be able to rock a top hat like that? Probably not. But soon, these other questions were too confusing. Confusing enough to drag a specific monochrome former YouTuber out of retirement, just to overanalyze this one book. On July 23rd, as soon as the books hit the shelves, I zoomed on over to my local Barnes & Noble, home to all these lovely, intricate works of fine literature, and grabbed myself a copy of the book with the big old triangle. They had two versions, and apparently the Barnes & Noble version had 16 extra pages, so of course I gotta nab that one. And then I read through it all. I scoured it for lore, and now I can tell you this. Bill Cipher is a preteen. The Book of Bill reveals quite a lot. New details about characters are exposed, more info about Bill's lore, and overall the universe is expanded. There's a lot to cover, but I'ma break it down in three parts. Why you should or shouldn't get the book. This is like my spoiler-free section if you're still on the fence. What do we learn about Bill Cipher? What secrets are revealed about him? And what do we learn that changes all of Gravity Falls as a series? So my spoiler-free review of the book, 10 deer teeth out of 10, Scrawls approved. If you like Gravity Falls and want to return to that universe, especially if you're a big fan of Bill Cipher's sense of humor, I'd recommend this book. If you like wacky shenanigans, secret codes, wonderful multimedia art, and bits of lore hidden between the lines of Bill's lunatics, I'd recommend this book heartily. But if those things don't appeal to you, you might want to skip it. The book itself is page after page of Bill's writing, him explaining the secrets of the universe, his own lore, tips on dating, all those things skewed through an unreliable, sometimes LOL random narrator who seems to really want your blood. I loved it. I'm definitely not being held hostage by Bill himself to say this. Of course not, why would you even say that? But seriously, a lot of the writing in this book is a bit silly and kind of Bill's brand of dark comedy, but I really enjoyed going through it and navigating his over-the-top, unpredictable perspectives on things. Plus, the art is incredible. Every page feels crafted with a lot of love, blood, and demonic magic. We get a lot of wonderful new pictures of Bill and other cosmic horrors, and the kind of mixed media combo of art and text and graphics and all of that works together to be pretty entertaining. And of course, like I said earlier, the book reveals quite a bit about Bill and the Gravity Falls universe. While most of the lore is revealed in smaller bits, this book definitely does tell us some bigger things that recontextualize Gravity Falls as a whole. And it, of course, reveals what happened to Bill. Bill is not dead. Not entirely. At the end of Gravity Falls, we all remember how Bill accidentally entered Stanley Pines' mind instead of Ford's. After toying with the Pines family time and time again and establishing Weirdmageddon, Bill finally got what he deserved. Stanford used the memory gun to destroy Stanley's mind with Bill inside. Bill was seemingly destroyed with nothing left of him except for a statue in the woods and way too many weird fanfictions online. Oh god. But of course, this book reveals a slightly different story. The Book of Bill is a compilation crafted by Bill himself in which he directly refers to a reader and wants to make a deal with them. He shares secrets, funny anecdotes, activities and stories, his backstory, and bits of the third journal. All to try to get the reader to help him escape. Escape what? You see, as Bill died, he made one last plea with the axolotl, an extra-dimensional being who is also very adorable. I love axolotls. They look so funky. In a distorted final message, Bill says, with this plea, he met with the axolotl, who in turn made a deal with Bill, putting him, a quirky edgelord, into his worst nightmare. Therapy. Sent to a place outside time called the Theraprism, the soul of Bill Cipher was put into indefinite karmic rehabilitation. Until he could properly manage his evil tendencies, he was trapped. But hey, maybe the King of Weird can come back one day, reincarnated as a butterfly or worm or something. During therapy, Bill was given time for arts and crafts, and he decided to use that time to create this weird book. He sent it back to the real world, trying to get someone, anyone, to become his willing puppet. The therapy guards found out, and now that scheme is over. The Book of Bill reveals a lot about Bill. We find out that he once dated a howling void, that the Oracle, Jessebram the Unswerving, used to be a henchmaniac, and we find out that Bill's not dead. Yet altogether, while Bill is able to exert his power through this book, his efforts reveal something bigger. Bill is desperate. He's pathetic, and he's surprisingly more human than he wants people to believe. He's petty, lonely, and homicidal. He's like the worst bits of humanity rolled into a four-sided dice. As alien as his biology is, and as flat as his geometry is, throughout the book it's shown that Bill is offended when people leave him, and that he may secretly admire parts of humanity, although it's layered through copious amounts of sarcasm and denial. In the section called Losing Sixer, Ford shut down the portal, effectively breaking up with his acutely maniacal muse. Bill writes, "I wasn't upset at all. In fact, I decided to prove how not upset I was about our falling out by knocking back a few cold glasses of I'm Fine juice." After becoming intoxicated, the suspect proceeded to have a meltdown. He used his reality warping to cause quite a stir in a local establishment, even turning a kid's head into a CGI watermelon. Later, he gets annoyed with himself for treating Sixer with any civility in the first place. He questions why he gave Sixer more time to decide. Was it because of some misplaced sentimentality? Look, Bill Cipher isn't some cold, unknowable eldritch god. In the Theraprism, he even pokes fun at the other loser-tier villains stuck in therapy with him that resemble more typical cosmic horrors. He's whiny, LOL random, an attention-seeker dealing with a string of bad breakups, and he's a being of emotions and stupidity and sentiment. Almost human. This connection to humanity's emotions is why he's able to manipulate people like Ford and Dipper. He understands what it's like to be an outcast and to feel alone, and he uses this understanding to trick those in his way. When he first meets Stanford, he tries a friendly angle, commiserating with him and calling out those who judge Stanford too harshly. Perhaps this comes easy because he himself was judged and excluded many times before. In the early years, he says that he was born with the rare mutation to see the third dimension. He also insists that he has always been loved and admired by all. But when he writes about how he freed his dimension from their delusions, the words are redacted with glitchy marks. Bill must have felt isolated or shunned for his ability to see into the third dimension and lashed out on a cosmic scale, taking his anger out on everyone. So whether it's Stanford having six fingers that makes him weird or Dipper having his constellation birthmark, Bill preys on those who live on the outsides. He relates to and manipulates these heroes because he gets exactly where they're coming from. Yet for having such a huge eye, he fails to ever look inward to his own flaws and emotionality. Instead of dealing with those silly little things like morality or empathy, he instead keeps moving towards constant hedonism. We know that he isn't incapable of feeling emotions. We see him get enraged when the Pine Twins piss him off, terrified when Stanley's about to kill him, and like I said earlier, he does subconsciously realize that there was some sort of connection between him and Sixer. But when Bill Cipher feels those impulsive human emotions, he lets them derail himself. The ones he deems good become heightened, while feelings like guilt or shame are buried so deep they might as well be in the bottomless pit. I'm not trying to say that he's a bad villain, quite the opposite. It makes it more entertaining to watch. And once you understand that he's an attention-seeking alien god on a crazy cosmic bender trying to avoid his past, the whole series makes a lot of sense. And this messed up but strangely human psyche makes him a perfect villainous match for Dipper and Mabel. Bill Cipher directly denies the claim that he's just a teenager. Instead, "That's ridiculous! I'm 1,012,000,000 years old! I'm a preteen!" Even this is something he acknowledges. He's moody and on the cusp of figuring things out but never fully being there. He's a cosmic preteen, making him the perfect villain to the Pines twins. Speaking of the Pines twins, Bill also drops a pretty big detail in this book about why he thinks they went on this trip to Gravity Falls in the first place. On the section on dreams, Bill says that Dipper has Recurring nightmares about overhearing a fight between his parents he wasn't supposed to hear. Why do you think they were in such a rush to get the kids out the door for the summer?
This implies that the whole reason Mabel and Dipper were shipped off to Gravity Falls for the summer was because their parents were having a pretty serious argument. Perhaps even discussing a divorce or affair. That completely recontextualizes a lot about the two and the series overall. Dipper's quest to understand the weirdness of Gravity Falls and Mabel's quest to kissing boys and being the weirdness in Gravity Falls both could be coping mechanisms for dealing with their parents' divorce, them distracting themselves with whatever they can, as something very real and serious looms above their heads. Dipper is trying to grow up to face this reality, while Mabel, she wants to stay in Gravity Falls for as long as she can, away from home, so she doesn't have to confront it. Dang, that's pretty depressing.
A silly show for kids, am I right?
The Book of Bill honestly proves that the world of Gravity Falls and its characters are rich enough to carry on. When Bill Cipher, Alex Hirsch, is allowed to explore the world building with less worry about censorship or younger audiences, we get to see the nasty, petty, and gruesome sides of Bill and the dark truths of the Pine Twins. And now that we know that Bill is just waiting for one person to give him a handshake, it seems all that much easier for the preteen triangle to return, not only in a spin-off book, but maybe in a Gravity Falls sequel series. Who knows? I'm sure we'll meet again.
Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Oh, by the way, I might post more cartoon analyses every now and then, so keep an eye out and look how cute my new persona is. Isn't he adorable?
The universe is a hologram, reality is illusion. Bye, gold. Bye.